Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Panzer Ace, the Memoirs of an Iron Cross Panzer Commander from Barbarossa to Normandy. By Richard Freiherr von Rosen. Foreword by Robert Forchik. Narrated by Nigel Patterson. Foreword by Robert Forchik. While there are many, many books about tanks in the Second World War, relatively few have been written by men who served as tank platoon leaders in that conflict. Two of the more memorable books in this category were Bob Crisp's Brazen Chariots, 1959, about his service in the 3rd Royal Tank Regiment in 1941, and Otto Karius's Tigers in the Mud, 1960, about his service in the 502nd Heavy Tank Battalion in 1943-44. In armoured warfare, it is young tank platoon leaders who lead from the front, but unfortunately few of these men survived the war. Most accounts of armed warfare were written by higher-level officers like Guderian, or staff officers who did not actually serve on tanks at the small unit level. Consequently, Panzer Ace, written by Richard Freiherr von Rosen, is a welcome addition to the exceedingly short list of Second World War tank platoon leader memoirs. As a former Cold War-era tank platoon leader myself, I found Panzer Ace to be a gripping frontline account that amply brings to life the day-to-day responsibilities and challenges facing junior leaders at the spearpoint of mobile warfare. The 18-year-old von Rosen entered the German army, Heer, in 1940 and was trained as a tanker during the winter of 1940-41. His first taste of battle was as a gunner on a Panzer III medium tank during the opening stages of Operation Barbarossa in 1941. In his opening vignettes, the author details the intense efforts that the Heer put into training its tankers, how tank crews were formed and vehicles provisioned for the campaign in Russia. I was surprised by the author's frank admission of widespread looting and intoxication by members of his battalion as they captured Russian towns, and a rather casual attitude towards local security in occupied areas. In Bob Crisp's earlier memoir, he referred to similar proclivities as swanning about. This is not how the Panzer spearheads are depicted in official histories, looting and drinking their way across Russia. On the other hand, the author's description of his crew's relentless quest to acquire creature comforts rings quite consistent with the behaviour of tankers from other armies. In von Rosen's unvarnished account, tankers are filthy, dog-tired, and focused on simple tasks, like keeping the air filters clean. Combat was short and violent. In his first real action, the author's entire 5-tank platoon was knocked out by concealed anti-tank guns, and only 11 of 25 crewmen survived after evading capture. However, tank units also suffered many non-battle casualties, and von Rosen was injured in an accident in August 1941 and sent back to Germany to recover. Von Rosen was certainly fortunate in missing most of the 1942 campaign in Russia and then being reassigned to the newly created 502nd Heavy Tank Battalion, the first German battalion equipped with the new Tiger I heavy tank. During his recovery, von Rosen received additional training and was commissioned as a Leutnant. In late December 1942, his unit was hurriedly transferred to southern Russia in response to the catastrophe at Stalingrad. It was in January 1943, on the frozen Kalmuck steppes, that von Rosen gained his first experience as a tank platoon leader. His unit, redesignated as the 503rd Heavy Tank Battalion, conducted a fighting withdrawal back to Rostov, then to the Kharkov area. Armoured delaying operations are one of the toughest missions that a platoon leader can receive, and conducting it amidst a Russian winter was no small accomplishment. Afterwards, von Rosen describes the lead-up to Operation Zitadelle, the German offensive against the Kursk Bulge, with interesting details about training and preparations. One of the author's most telling observations about Kursk was, "We would discover that the Russian soldier we would face was no longer the man of 1941-42, but a soldier our equal in fighting efficiency and morale." The detailed descriptions that von Rosen provides of tank combat during the Battle of Kursk are some of the best that I have read, rich with significant points that are often overlooked in other accounts. Not surprisingly, given the fierce Soviet resistance, von Rosen was wounded in action during the battle and again sent back to Germany. After nearly a year away from the front, von Rosen returned to duty in June 1944, just as his battalion was transferred to France to deal with the Allied invasion of Normandy. Although the 503rd Heavy Tank Battalion played a major role in frustrating the British offensive known as Operation Goodwood, the battalion was eventually ground down by heavy losses. The author's descriptions of Allied artillery barrages and air attacks indicate how German panzers could no longer operate in broad daylight as they had earlier in the war. After the Allied breakout from Normandy, von Rosen managed to reach Germany, where his unit was re-equipped with the new King Tiger heavy tank. In September 1944, von Rosen was promoted to company commander. However, he notes how veteran tank crews had become a precious commodity, and his former commander tried to pinch some of his best tankers from him. The Third Reich's manpower crisis was becoming acute, and the author notes that the quality of the German NCO corps had begun to decline, and that some of his replacements were far less effective than the soldiers of 1941-42. After a brief period of reconstitution, von Rosen's company was sent to Hungary in October 1944 to try and prevent the loss of Budapest to the advancing Red Army. In Hungary, von Rosen found that even the King Tiger was challenged by the increased skill of Soviet anti-tank defences, noting, "It was a grim feeling to be sitting in a panzer, see a muzzle flash ahead, and then wait for the hit. We could receive a hit so powerfully that it stunned us all." It is also amazing to read how the German High Command foolishly employed the King Tigers on marshy terrain, which put them at a clear disadvantage. On soft ground, the King Tigers were easily mired, and on one day von Rosen had five of his tanks stuck, which required retrieval under fire, a nightmare for any armour leader. The rainy autumn weather in Hungary seriously hindered German efforts to counter-attack Soviet breakthroughs, and von Rosen's recollections of rain-soaked nights inside his Tiger are particularly poignant for tankers. One might think that a panzer was watertight. On the contrary, water always found its way in. Because movement in the panzer was very limited by how cramped it was, if it rained all day, it was very unpleasant inside. Constant drips falling on your head or neck could drive you mad. I had similar experiences during monsoon season in Korea in my M60A3 tank, long nights of water torture in tight spaces that one never forgets. Von Rosen's final months in combat were a daily struggle to keep his remaining King Tigers operational, and he gives due credit to the efforts of his technical NCOs in the repair group. However, even skilled mechanics could not keep up with the amount of combat-damaged and broken-down vehicles, which reduced von Rosen's company to just a handful of operational tanks. Eventually, vehicle recovery became the primary daily mission, without which the company would have quickly disintegrated. Aside from weather and losses, the author also notes how the awful state of German infantry at this stage of the war, men he described as poorly armed and lacking any motivation, along with the lack of artillery or air support, prevented operational success. By late 1944, the Heer was no longer capable of conducting the kind of combined arms operations that had led to rapid success in 1940-41. Furthermore, the appearance of Soviet heavy tanks began to threaten even the King Tiger's aura of invincibility, and he describes one occasion in January 1945 when four of his tanks were knocked out by concealed Su-152 assault guns. Von Rosen was wounded in December 1944, but remained with his company until severely wounded again in February 1945. At that point, he was fortunate in being sent to a military hospital in Bavaria, which fell in the American sector of occupation. Other members of his unit were captured by the advancing Red Army. Like many German Second World War memoirs, von Rosen's tries to avoid political questions or reflection about the Nazi regime, but we get some glimpses in the final section of Panzer Ace, which covers the author's immediate post-war experiences. Von Rosen is sharply critical of the French occupation forces, while forgetting that millions of foreigners suffered under German occupation for 4 long years. He is particularly critical of French looting in Germany and the imposition of harsh food rationing, although Germans looted France and imposed equally harsh rationing. In the final section, the author also makes it clear that he had a low opinion of Nazi politicians, and eventually Hitler. Furthermore, he does concede that the Germans' defeat was due to their own mistakes, and that he had unwittingly fought for a criminal regime, something not all German memoirs were willing to admit. Afterwards, von Rosen went on to serve 22 years in the post-war Bundeswehr, and rose to become a Panzerbrigade commander, but he does not cover this period, which is unfortunate. It would have been interesting to read how the author's wartime experiences influenced the training of his post-war tank units, although this is understandably a touchy subject, even today in Germany. The format of Panzer Ace allows the author to address a great many tactical details of interest to modern historians, such as what panzer crews ate and their routine of daily life while on campaign. For modern tankers, it is also interesting to read about the difficulties of tank recovery in field conditions and the trials of keeping a functional radio net under combat conditions, which is harder than it seems. Von Rosen's memoir provides a valuable and frank first-person narrative of panzer operations in the period 1941-45, which helps to dispel some of the gloss put on by official histories. The result is a more honest appraisal of what it was like to be a successful small unit armor leader for 4 years of intense combat. Author's foreword. One is justified in asking why I have left it so late in life to publish my memoirs. After all, I wrote them years ago when my mind was clearer, and I could refer back to my diaries and the many field post letters which my parents had kept. I have written down my war experiences for my children and grandchildren, since they found it difficult to imagine what someone born around 1922 had had to go through. They had only known freedom and security, and were curious to find out how it had been for me. When the Second World War began, I was 17 and still at high school, swatting Greek, Latin, and mathematics. At age 18, I was called up, and at 19, I had my first narrow escape from death in Russia. On my 21st birthday, I led my platoon of 4 Tiger Panzers at the Battle of Kursk, and exactly a year later, I was aboard a panzer transport train for Normandy. 2 days after my 23rd birthday, I was released as a prisoner of war and returned home. That was my youth, a time of anxiety and great concern, more for my family than for my own life. Most of my contemporaries came through it, but many did not live to see the end of the war. We went on the battlefield to protect the fatherland, or at least we believed that was the reason. We spent little time pondering who had caused and begun this war and why. Prove yourself was my motto, shared by many of my comrades in arms. Our parents had no say in the matter. After I was called up, I had the great fortune to be led by men who were first of all human beings and not just soldiers. I became an adult, and they influenced my development. As I look back at my zealous youth, they were and remain for me models of the human and soldierly virtues. They placed their trust in me and showed me so by giving me responsibilities early on, which were often matters of life and death. Without their help and leadership, I would not have been able to master it all. I dedicate this memoir to the memory of the 7 men who still remain close today to this 90-year-old. I also devote this memoir to the panzer men of No. 3 Company of the 503rd Heavy Tank Battalion, to whom I was a comrade, although senior in rank. The bond of friendship has held firm to the present day. 1. The Second World War begins. As late as July and August 1939, we were at Oberbärenburg in the Erzgebirge as usual. Nothing was different on this visit from the previous ones. We went on many rambles with Mother, including into the Sudetenland, which had been annexed in October 1938, for example to the convent church at Mariaschein and into the Bohemian mountains. I myself had got to Oberbärenburg by motorcycle and used it to make quite a few excursions, visiting Saxon Switzerland and Dresden. I read the newspapers very attentively and listened every day to the news bulletins. Just as in 1938, the increasingly tense foreign policy situation could be sensed everywhere. The atmosphere became ever more oppressive in the second half of August. Air raid sirens were tested and practice blackouts carried out, private vehicles requisitioned and reservists called up. All this pointed towards the impending conflict. We had entered the last 10 days of peace. The radio broadcast endless military music and unflinching new reports regarding atrocities by the Poles against Volksdeutsche, with news bulletins with ever more dangerous threats sandwiched in between. Many of the reported attacks had been staged by the Nazis, such as the incident at the Gleiwitz radio station on the 31st of August, but others actually did happen. Whom should one believe? A typical comment by adults was, "Without a miracle, war with Poland cannot be avoided," or, "Once the harvest is in, it will start." On the 23rd of August, we breathed a sigh of relief. Shortly before, the unexpected had come to pass. Behind the backs of the Western Allies, the arch-enemies Hitler and Stalin had concluded a non-aggression pact. There was a secret protocol, hardly any knowledge of which had been made public, in which the Baltic states had been conceded to the Soviets' sphere of influence. Would this enable the calamity to be avoided at the last moment? Everybody prayed for it. On the afternoon of the 31st of August, there was only one subject of discussion. The Reichstag had been summoned for the following day to hear a declaration by the Reich government. It was fairly clear what this meant. On Friday, the 1st of September, everybody sat by their radio sets, my family too. Finally came Hitler's voice, with the sentence announcing the disaster. "Since 5:45 we have been shooting back." Now it was official. We were at war. Depression reigned. What would we soon be having to face? The grown-ups remembered the awful war years of 1917 and 1918, the turnip and Swede winter, the shortage of coal, military hospitals filled to overflowing, and so many families in mourning. Soon the radio announced the first measures. Food ration cards, clothing coupons classified by age and gender, petrol rationing, travel restrictions, coal quotas, frantic activity. Everything had already been prepared. In the years that followed, we would have to have a blackout, have to hoard, have to evacuate. The only sources of information were the official Reich radio service, which broadcast reports prepared by the propaganda ministry, and the newspapers, controlled by the same body. Listening to foreign radio stations was not yet illegal, but for the most part their broadcasts in times of crisis did not provide the true circumstances affecting Germany. In any case, their customary exaggerations condemned them as a non-credible source. East Prussia had been separated geographically from the Reich since 1919, and the Reich's claim for an extraterritorial railway line and road across the Polish corridor to connect with it seemed to me reasonable. Also that Danzig, which had been placed under a League of Nations mandate by the Treaty of Versailles, should be returned to the Reich. I found the claims of Polish atrocities against the citizens of German stock in the Polish corridor and the province of Posen believable, while being dubious about the alleged Polish attack on the Gliwice radio station. To a certain extent, there was little sympathy for the Poles, but a future war against the Western powers was considered a great danger, and there was no possibility of avoiding it. Even amongst my own generation, there was little euphoria and enthusiasm for a war, but if the fatherland was in danger, then one had to make a stand and become involved. Whatever events had unleashed the war were irrelevant. Many believed secretly that it would be a short war, ending with a quick victory. The very first special bulletins from Poland reinforced the hope that, once again, the Führer was right. Then, 2 days later, came the damper. It was Sunday, and Aunt Ina had heard on the radio that France and Britain had declared war on Germany. A local war against Poland was developing into a kind of world war, for Great Britain brought into the war the British Empire, Australia and New Zealand, India, and a few days later the South African Union and Canada. This did not look good. I prepared for my return journey to Rastatt. Private journeys by car or motorcycle were forbidden, and so I had to go to the office of the district administrator at Dipoldiswalde for an exemption certificate. I also received a docket allowing me 5 litres of petrol, enough to get me home to Rastatt. After breakfast on the 9th of September, I set out and spent that night in the Panzer barracks at Bamberg, which I would enter 14 months later as a soldier. The next day, I arrived at Rastatt. I became a dispatch rider for the military district and had a red corner stamped onto my number plate, which showed my authority to use my motorcycle. Rastatt was in the so-called Red Zone, which was being evacuated. Women and children had already gone, and all schools and most businesses had shut down. The nearby Rhine front was very quiet, the French idle in their Maginot Line, the Germans behind their Westwall. Only the big bridge at Wintersdorf had been demolished. Neither side wanted to fire on the other, and a friendly traffic existed across both sides of the Rhine. At least that was how it was on the Upper Rhine, the end nearest Switzerland. In those days they called it the drôle de guerre, the phony war. I made myself useful at home. The nightly blackout was strictly enforced. Slackness attracted a fine. Not just once did the neighbourhood warden hammer on the door and shout, "Blackout!" Not the slightest chink of light must be seen from outside. In peacetime, air raid and blackout practices had often been held, but these were not taken too seriously. One only bothered with the rooms being occupied at the time. But now it was part of everyday wartime life. Here was something I could do to keep myself busy. Wooden frames had to be made and covered with black paper to put over the windows in the evening. Makeshift solutions were no longer acceptable. Everything had to be done for the long term. In time, the system was perfected. Black curtains for the bedrooms, while rooms with sliding shutters or blinds had only the air slits pasted over. These were checked from time to time. There was no longer any street lighting. The neighbourhoods were black as pitch. In train compartments, only a dim blue light was permitted, while all road vehicles had to place a cap with a small slit over their headlights so that one could be seen by oncoming traffic. Even pocket lamps had to have a cover projecting the light down onto one's feet. Pedestrians wore phosphorescent badges on their lapels to avoid colliding. An air raid shelter was set up in our cellar, which in May 1940 offered us protection from French artillery fire. From October 1939, I attended high school at Baden-Baden. There were just a few of us who met up each morning on Rastatt railway station. Mostly we did go to school, but occasionally preferred to climb the Battert, a 570-metre hill on the edge of the Black Forest, or spent the morning in the reading room at the Spa House. We were known to the people of Baden-Baden as the Westwall Gypsies, and it was rare that any of us was absent. Our schools were reopened on the 7th of January 1940, but closed again shortly afterwards. It was a bitterly cold winter, and no coke was available for heating purposes. At the beginning of February 1940, I submitted my application as a volunteer for the Army Officers Course, since that had always been my ambition. My papers were sent to the Panzer troops. At the end of that month, I was accepted as a volunteer, and shortly afterwards passed the medical as fit for war duty. At the beginning of July, I attended for psychological testing at Stuttgart for 2.5 days. This course was feared, and the failure rate high, but I returned home with a feeling of confidence. Meanwhile, the 8th grade scholars, amongst whom I had been transferred at Easter, had been informed officially that every one of them called up for military service would be awarded the Abitur, secondary school graduation certificate, if conduct and achievements in class justify it. Accordingly, from early summer 1940, most of my class had left, the majority to enlist voluntarily, some into the SS, after doing 3 months compulsory labour service with the Reicharbeitdienst, RAD, State Labour Service. On the other hand, I was informed by the military district command that I could expect to be called up on the 1st of October. It seemed that my hopes were to be fulfilled. As an aspirant for an active officer's career, I was exempt from the RAD. My mood after the initial military successes was almost euphoric. To have preempted the British in Norway was a masterstroke. The Battle of Narvik was extremely dramatic. General Dietl defended the town for 4 weeks in the mountains between Narvik and the Swedish border with his force of Bavarian and Austrian mountain troops. He became a national hero. The British retreat from Norway at the end of May 1940 was seen as a clear indication of the superiority of the Wehrmacht over them, at least in the air and on land. The unleashing of the campaign in the West simultaneously with the operation in Norway was completely unexpected, and thus came as a surprise to the German people. The violation of Belgian and Dutch neutrality was accepted as a necessity. The German successes in the West were at first almost unbelievable. Every day my father and I would advance coloured pins on a map to show the new front line as reported by frequent special reports and the Wehrmacht bulletins. Our radio was left on all day so as not to miss anything. At that time, at the time of our national success, the Wehrmacht bulletins were always very credible and unvarnished. It filled us with great satisfaction that the armistice was signed at the same place, Compiègne, in the same railway carriage and with the same ceremony as for the German capitulation in 1918. The previous shame was atoned for. Now we could be very accommodating and generous in the armistice negotiations, or in any case, it seemed that this should be so. Over the next few days, German convoys coming from France rolled endlessly from dawn until dusk to their peacetime garrisons at Rastatt. They included the Rastatt Infantry Regiment 111 and Artillery Battalion 35. Great enthusiasm and relief. Crowds waving and flowers. Everything as it should be to welcome home a conquering army. And there was I, still in school. I bought a map of England, for now we were all sure that England was next. As we know now, we were mistaken. Now my hour had come. On the 18th of October 1940, I received my call up to the 35th Replacement Tank Battalion at Bamberg. My wish to serve with the panzers as an officer aspirant was to be fulfilled. The letter was waiting for me when I got home from school at midday. My mother opened the door and led me rather ceremoniously to the dining table, which lay prepared. She told me later how much she was impressed by the happiness shining in my face as I read the content of the letter. In accordance to my plan, I was now a soldier, no longer a dream, but reality. After lunch, I cycled into town in order to tell as many of my classmates or acquaintances as possible of my good fortune. "But once you're trained, the war will be long over," I thought to myself. "Maybe I might be a soldier of the occupation in France." If I had only suspected what was yet to come in the war, and how many years yet it would last. My father feared as much. The victories in Poland and France did nothing to lessen his foreboding that none of our enemies would ever conclude a peace treaty with Hitler. At that time, it did not worry me what he said. I went to school next day, took leave of my professors and classmates, and reported my departure to the director. Thus ended my schooling, longed for, but still very odd. I had 5 days left before my parents escorted me to the railway station and waved me off to Bamberg Garrison. With an excited feeling in my stomach, I reported to the officer of the watch at the Panzer Barracks. Number 3 Company was expecting us, 41 18-year-old boys for training with Panzer Regiments 35 and 36. 8 to a room, we stretched out and sized each other up. What kind of hotshots they were. With the girls, at sport or drinking beer. For me, apart from sport, this was virgin territory. All the same, I accompanied them to the canteen and drank my first beer. It tasted ghastly, but it was what men did. Next day, the life began in earnest. We were always on the go from 6 a.m. until curfew at 10, exercises and more exercises. A horde of instructors were let loose on us. "Officer candidates? Well, we'll see about that." I spent more time on the ground than standing up. For a change, there was tuition, some weapons training. "Into how many parts can you dismantle a rifle? cleaning the barrack room, uniform or locker inspections, always followed by the check-up inspection. Yet all this crap even gave us pleasure. We are hard men, they will never force us under. And the first song we learned was Es ist so schön, Soldat zu sein, Anna-Marie. It's so wonderful to be a soldier, Anna-Marie. After 14 days at Bamberg, we were transferred. I went with 20 of my co-recruits to our field unit, Panzer Regiment 35, at Auxerre, on the Yonne in France, where we were assigned to an officer aspirants course. Our instructor was Oberleutnant Schultz, after the war a military attaché to the Bundestag. When he was around, our instructors suddenly became human. Otherwise, we had nothing to laugh about. Two Obergefreiter, auxiliary instructors, were extremely sadistic. This period was hellish because we were entirely at their mercy. Nobody dared complain because we were expected to be able to stand it. These primitive beings especially had it in for me because I was a fawn. After curfew one evening, they roused us from bed in our pyjamas and made us crawl across the muddy village street where a herd of sheep had been in the afternoon. I lost my self-control. It was all because one of my colleagues had a drop of coffee in his field flask at room inspection. When the light was put out and we lay on our straw sacks in our filthy pyjamas, I drew the blanket over my head and howled in anger. I had never before imagined that men could be so foul. But my defiance also grew. Don't let it get you down. They must not have their victory. We were introduced individually to the regimental commander, Oberst Eberbach. He was very human, hearty, and interested. I noticed by his questions and the manner of his leave-taking that he was well disposed to me. I was appeased. At the beginning of December 1940, the regiment moved to the Rhineland. Our course was now held in the large hall of the Windhövel Inn at Solingen-Hirscheid. The proprietress, Aunt Ella, was a determined personality who made sure that the instructors did not treat us too badly in our off-duty hours. From the 13th of December 1940, I was laid up in the military hospital at Wuppertal-Elberfeld with an infected foot, over Christmas and New Year too. When I returned to the course on the 26th of January 1941, Panzer driving training had begun. That was a good time. We arranged it so that we always drove past the girls' high school with our Panzer I training tank during their long lunch break and did a lap of honour around the courtyard. We laid it on pretty thick, but unfortunately we never had leave, and so there was no opportunity to return the sympathy shown us. Our course ended on the 6th of February 1941. Another transfer was in the offing for the regiment, but before that, we officer aspirants were now classified as Fahnenjunker, officer cadets, senior grade, and spread over the 8 companies of Panzer Regiment 35. I went to No. 1 Company with Ecker Zolf, soon to fall in Russia. The company commander was Oberleutnant von Kossel. We were lodged in billets in the village of Patscheid, near Opladen. Zolf and I were taken into the house of Father Zimmermann, the local Catholic priest. We had a superb suite with bathroom and proper beds. Long afterwards, I kept in touch with him by letter. In mid-February 1941, the regiment was transferred to the Cognac region of southern France. Our number one company was in the small village of Marignac and received new recruits. Some of them were lodged in the village school. I was the room senior. A large room, 13 beds with straw sacks, no locker, a water tap in the schoolyard. It was difficult to keep oneself clean. The commander and part of the company staff occupied a small chateau about a kilometre outside the village on a ridge affording a panorama over the countryside. Vineyards all around. We Fahnenjunker had to eat every midday in the company officer's mess. Really, it was very pleasant to be with men who knew how to eat with a knife and fork and conversed in a cultured manner and to be served by orderlies. For us, this meant a shorter midday break, involving washing, changing into uniform, a long run to the chateau, and after dining, a long run back to change in order to present oneself promptly for the afternoon session. Woe betide us if we arrived late. Naturally, the gentleman officer aspirants. Once a week, it was gentlemen's evening at the chateau. The food was better, served with fine Bordeaux wines, A fire burnt in the hearth, and we relaxed in soft leather armchairs. Oberleutnant von Kossel was pleasant, communicative, interested, and humorous. I was in his good books. The training schedule was now primarily panzer training with hardly any more discipline training, and we had a lot of fun. Additionally, I was no longer a recruit. I stood guard, and also had duties as an auxiliary instructor. In mid-March 1941, we were transferred to the Burgenland in Austria shortly after the Balkan campaign began. This came as a great surprise to all of us. The offensive resulted from the need to protect our Italian allies against the threat of defeat in Greece, their invasion not having been agreed beforehand with Hitler, and to prevent the British gaining a foothold there. Everything was settled so quickly, however, that we were not called for. At that time, I was promoted to Fahnen- und Junkergefreiter, officer cadet senior grade, private soldier. Now I was a proper soldier. We spent a whole Saturday in Vienna, glorious, but it could not be repeated. Once again, we were transported away by train, cattle wagons, straw, soot, and filth. The train rattled through the protectorate of Bohemia and Moravia. Where was this train going? On the 25th of April 1941, my company arrived at the Wartelager, a large military training depot near Posen in the former Wartegau, now in Poland. It was a beautiful time of year, a glorious spring. On Saturdays and Sundays, a company lorry drove into Posen. I always went if I was off duty. There, I would meet my godfather, Willy Seidlitz, for a good meal. Every Saturday evening, I went to the theatre or the opera, then caught the lorry for the 20 kilometres back to the camp. I also called on the Scheinpflugs, my friends from Oberbärenburg. Being from the Baltic states, the father had meanwhile landed up in Posen. I and my two friends played with model trains. As I was leaving, Frau Scheinpflug said to me, "Your poor mother." I believe that both her sons became soldiers. The war went on long enough for them to qualify. In the regiment, rumours were rife as to how things would turn out next. Either the USSR would allow us free passage into Persia or Iraq, from where we would break through to the Suez Canal, the Red Sea, and Egypt. The Russians had placed a railway line and a highway at our disposal. Or we were to relieve Rommel. Nobody thought of an attack on the USSR. By the 1st of May 1941, all elements of the 4th Armoured Division, of which our 35th Panzer Regiment was part, had assembled in the Wartelager. A lively series of exercises began. Almost daily we drove short or long distances, great importance being placed on crossing swamps. It often happened that the entire company would bog down in swampy land and have to be pulled free by the heavy tractors of the workshop company. Great emphasis was also placed on anti-gas training. They kept telling us that we could almost count on gas attacks by our next opponents. My panzer was laid up for a longish period in the workshop. I spent half a day helping out there and learned a lot. After about 5 weeks, the company had an inspection and emerged faultless. It had carried out all work asked of it, except for our panzer, which bogged down in a swamp. The regimental commander, Colonel Eberbach, shit on the driver from a great height for this. Besides panzer training, we had many uniform parades, masked balls and so on, arranged by our Spieß, Hauptfeldwebel Klepzig. In this manner, the 7 weeks at the troop training depot passed by quickly. Now and again there was some talk of an operation against Russia. In the final week of our training at Wartelager, the 35th Panzer Regiment received 50 new Panzer IIIs, of which 8 came to our No. 1 company. The company was now equipped with 17 Panzer IIIs. 11 had a 5cm gun, and 6 a 3.7cm gun. The two Panzer IIs each had a 2cm gun. I had been in the rank of Gefreiter since March 1941, and became the gunner in a Panzer III with a 5cm 38 L42 main gun and two coaxial 7.92mm MG34s. The 22-ton Panzer III Special Purpose Vehicle 141 had 5 crew: commander, driver, radio operator, gunner, and loader. We carried loose with us 1 submachine gun, 5 Luger pistols, and a quantity of egg grenades and stick grenades. The firepower of a single panzer was therefore impressive, besides which it was well armoured and fairly fast. Oberleutnant von Kossel, our company commander, was 24 years of age, and for me embodied the ideal type of officer. We would all go through fire for him. He came originally from the cavalry and influenced me with his very human manner of company leadership and dealings with the men. His bravery and calmness, even in critical situations, impressed me again and again. In every respect, he was the model officer for me. The final days brought us a lot of work. The new weapons had to be zeroed in and calibrated, the gyro compass installed, the panzer loaded up. It was extraordinary how much gear and equipment had to be put into a tank, and with proper handling, it all fitted in. I sent my valuables home. The orders to roll could arrive at any time. 2. On the Eastern Front, June to August, 1941. At 1900 hours on the 11th of June, 1941, the company moved out of the Wartelager for the nearest railway station and loaded up there during the night until 0300 hours. This was very difficult in the dark, since there had to be a total blackout, but it went off without a hitch. The train began rolling towards dawn, steamed across Poland and pulled into Warsaw at 1900 hours. The city made a strange impression on all of us because there was no blackout. Lights were on in the tall buildings, in the tram cars and so on, something which we were no longer accustomed to after 2 years at war. At 0300 hours next morning we reached Siedlce, 70 kilometres from the German-Soviet border. At 0430 hours we began unloading the panzers, which took only half an hour because the ramps were extremely suitable for the purpose. At 0700 hours we set off for the border. On the dusty Polish highway it cost us half a day. For most of us, what we saw was totally new, although those who had been in the Polish campaign were already accustomed to it. The houses were all wooden, with only a thatched roof. There were no brick buildings at all, and the wells were quite peculiar. It was a preview of what we were to see later, week after week, in Russia. Even the small towns were built of wood. We especially noticed the many Jews here, identified by the yellow star. Our readiness areas were precisely laid out. The endless great forests turned into one giant troop depot. Division after division lay here, completely camouflaged against air reconnaissance. The regiment lay in the Vohynia area. Our number one company had its quarters in the middle of the forest. We lay there for 4 days, each crew putting up a tent. The weather was wonderful, and we were occupied all day with technical duties, which in such an environment provoked a lot of fun. These woods were quite magnificent, all deciduous trees. The only bad thing was the many mosquitoes which bred in the nearby Rokitnos swamps. After 4 days it began to rain so heavily that we were driven out of our tents, and the personnel moved into a barracks 5 kilometres away, where the company was given comfortable and above all dry quarters. We brought up the panzers to a wood closer at hand, camouflaged them perfectly against aerial reconnaissance, and carried out the duties of oil changing, weapons cleaning, and, most important of all, the fitting of a new refueling system using a petrol trailer. Each panzer had one of these two-wheeled trailers carrying 2 200-litre barrels to be towed behind it, inside which was a pump for refueling on the move. Before combat, the trailer could be released without difficulty from inside the panzer. The whole thing was found to be unsatisfactory, however, and was later discarded. It was a devil of a job to fit the system, but we succeeded. On the 16th of June 1941, we loaded live ammunition, which took us all day. We had to ship aboard each panzer about 4,000 machine gun rounds and fill the ammunition belts with them. Also around 70 high explosive and 60 armor-piercing shells and 10 special shells. Pistol rounds, flares and hand grenades were also loaded and primed. The same day we were immunized against cholera. This was done twice before the operation. In the evenings I went from number 3 company with 4 men to number 4 company, where Oberleutnant Kraus gave us a brief introduction to the Russian language. Apart from writing the Russian alphabet, we also learned some expressions useful on operations. I never understood anything else of it. Towards evening, on the 18th of June, the commander assembled us to give notice that the operation would begin within the next few days. Then he notified our company of its first objective. We were to be the spearhead company, and our orders were to move as fast as possible through thick woodlands with swampy marshes to the town of Kobrynia, which was 60 kilometres the other side of the border. The strength of the Soviet forces at the border was not known for certain. Our leading panzer was 114, with Unteroffizier Probst as commander. We had mixed feelings now that we knew that in a few days everything which until then had been harmless fun would come to be in bitter earnest. In the evening, the sentries were doubled in case the Soviets dropped paratroops. The day of the 20th of June began with regimental roll call. The entire 35th Panzer Regiment was formed into a triangle for Oberst Eberbach to address us. He spoke grippingly and warned us about the Russians. "You are going into a country in which the people live so primitively that you won't believe it. They don't even have proper toilets." Possibly he spoke in this manner to calm our anxieties or to instill in us a feeling of superiority. In conclusion, we remembered our fallen comrades on the battlefields in Poland and France, then returned to our quarters. On the morning of the 21st of June, we loaded all our personal belongings into the panzer. Space was limited, and it was no easy task. All panzers had a metal container behind the turret known as the rucksack, into which every crewman could stow a small travel bag, his overcoat, and a few personal items. A second travel bag had to be given up beforehand and went with the divisional baggage train. At the rear of the panzer was a large wooden trunk for blankets, ground sheets, and the like. There was also space in it for brochures, that is, plunder. For that reason, it was also known as the brochure trunk. Almost every panzer had one. We fixed an empty ammunition box on the track cover. These were small wooden boxes with a good clasp and an interior lining of sheet metal for our rations. A wire was wound around the rucksack, and we hung our field flasks from it so that they were always ready to hand. On the day before the invasion, we received our special rations, for which we found space in the engine compartment and fighting compartment. They consisted of 3 tins of rice or vegetables, 5 small sacks of bread, 3 boxes of Coca-Cola, and a miniature stove per man. This was in addition to our iron rations. None of it could be touched unless ordered. Towards midday, everything was ready. At 1600 hours, the company assembled to hear the commander's brief address in his usual humorous style. Then we were dismissed to our panzers nearby, which had been towed out of the woods and lined up on the highway. Around 1700 hours, the battalion HQ rolled past, and we followed, driving through Vohynia, then onwards to Brest-Litovsk. Our destination was woods north of the town, about 3 kilometres from the river Bug, which formed part of the frontier at that point. On the way, we drove past gigantic fuel dumps, which the RAD had laid out within the vast forests. The RAD boys stood on either side of the highway, watching us enviously. At nightfall, the drivers had the difficulty of driving in the dark. Now and again, a short technical halt would be made. Meanwhile, I slept on my gunner seat. It was a slow process, learning to sleep just anywhere. The seat was neither soft nor comfortable, and I was so tall that I could not sleep sitting upright. But in the end, I did get used to it. When I awoke at midnight, I found that we had reached our readiness area. Individual panzers were shown to their appointed places, fueled up, gun and machine gun barrels given a clean and drained of oil, all vehicles impeccably camouflaged, the tracks covered over, and now it was serious. We were told to keep a watch for enemy aircraft. All jobs done, everybody stretched out and tried to sleep. If the code word was given, the operation would begin at 03:15 hours. If not, we would have to stand by. The operation begins. 22nd of June, 1941. I had had a light doze. By 0300 hours, on account of the tension and excitement, nobody was still asleep. We got up and talked. Then, at precisely 0315 hours, the first rounds were fired. Our artillery batteries opened a crazy heavy fire from all sides on the Russian positions. Close by us was a 10.5-centimetre battery. After a short while, the morning sky had turned red. Wherever one looked was on fire. The Soviets made no reply. After half an hour, the firing ebbed somewhat, got stronger again, then almost ceased altogether. We could hear the rat-a-tat-tat of machine-gun fire in the distance. Our infantry crossed the bog and established a bridgehead. Towards 0400 hours, the entire fighting force of the company was drawn up, to hear the commander reading the Führer's order of the day to the German Army of the East. "The hour of the crucial test has now arrived for you too. Upon you lies the responsibility of saving the culture of Europe from Bolshevism." Our wheeled vehicles, classified as Tross, the rearward services, had not come up this far. A panzer company was made up of the Panzerkreuz, the Kampfstaffel, or battle component, divided up into the Gefechtstross, the combat train, including the field kitchen, and Tross 1 and 2. Tross 1 included the repair unit, ammunition and radio. Tross 2 was the wheeled Tross, with the orderly room, motor pool, provisions, clothing, weapons and equipment, motorcycle dispatch riders, drivers, paramedics, and so on. Our morale was excellent. Towards daybreak, we received another delivery of field post, then waited for our orders to move out. Our infantry and pioneers ahead at the Bug River were not ready for us yet. During the early morning, the infantry had established a bridgehead over the Bug without many losses, and the pioneers were now at work erecting a makeshift bridge. They completed it around midday, and at 1300 hours, my number one company received orders to move out. As soon as we got into gear on the highway, the battle with the dust began. Without our issue of protective goggles, we would have been blind. The convoys snaked their way from all sides onto our highway. We had priority everywhere, since we were the spearhead company of the Panzer Division. On the way there were several stops for congestion on the road. Here, the first two German wounded, an Unteroffizier and a Gefreiter from the 12th Infantry Regiment of the 4th Armoured Division, spoke to us. Both had minor wounds and told us about the Russians' tactics. The infantry had found it very difficult to make progress on the other side because of the swampy terrain. Towards 1500 hours, we reached the makeshift bridge over the Bug. The river here was about 150 metres wide. We had to wait for over an hour because the bridge had been damaged by the weight of troops passing over it. At about 1630 hours, the company finally crossed it, and now we were on Russian soil. A slug of cognac, and on we went. Soon we saw the first prisoners, escorted by infantry. They had good uniforms, the mud on it providing good camouflage. On the Russian side, it was very marshy, and we had to take care not to bog down. We got through without a hitch. The company formed up, and we set off in good order at a decent pace, first through woods already cleared by the infantry and littered with Russian equipment. They had pulled back very hastily. After about 5 kilometres, a halt was called to give the battalion a chance to form up. The battalion commander, Major von Lauchert, came forward to us. Number 1 company was now given another 3 Panzer IVs with a 7.5cm gun and 2 machine guns, and got ready for the drive to Corbigne. On the way, enemy resistance was to be expected. Our spearhead panzer was commanded by Unteroffizier Pröbster, then came Leutnant König, and the number 1 group vehicle with the company commander, followed by 3 Panzer IVs, our hard nuts to crack, the 2nd platoon, the light platoon, and finally the 3rd platoon. Behind us rolled number 2, 3 and 4 companies, then the 2nd battalion. Other elements, such as anti-tank guns, pioneers, artillery and so on, had been attached to our regiment, and as a whole within the division formed the assault group Eberbach, named after our regimental commander, Oberst Eberbach. He had already been awarded the Knight's Cross in France, and at the end of 1941 was only the 2nd officer of the Panzer Arm to receive the oak leaves for the outstanding successes of his assault group. Our task was now to force our way as deeply as possible into enemy territory. At dusk that first night, we set off at about 2100 hours and headed into the unknown. At first, we crossed open country. Behind a hedge, I saw my first dead Russians. The sight of it never gave me pleasure to the extent that I imagined it would earlier. We assumed that the enemy would be positioned behind every clump of woodland, and found it incomprehensible that he had not prepared his defence in those areas of territory ideal for it. The spearhead panzer reported all details to the commander by radio. Every panzer had at least a receiver, a large number of them a transmitter also. The convoy followed a woodland trail through the thickest area of forests. Of the enemy, there was no sign. Slowly, night came. Our morale was sky high. I sat behind my weapon, but the night was black as pitch, and since I could see nothing through the sight, I had a sleep, as did my loader, Gefreiter Eskliman, whose peace was always difficult to disturb. Following the changeover, our new commander, Feldwebel Woltz, stood in the turret and maintained contact with the driver, Gefreiter Jentschek, via the intercom system. In the darkness, the commander had to give steering directions to the driver, for on such a dark night and with the tremendous dust being kicked up, the driver could see very little through his viewing slit. Getting out during a short rest, one would sink ankle deep in the fine sand. We proceeded on narrow forest tracks with few halts, the leading panzer maintaining constant radio contact with the company. Towards midnight, we reached the major Brest-Litovsk Rollbahn without having met any enemy. This Rollbahn was the road to our destination.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.